Hey everybody, this is Shane from Shane's Books and Review, and I hope that you are having a wonderful day today. This will be the wrap-up video for The Return of Sherlock Holmes, which was wrote by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Today's first story will be The Adventure of the Abbey Grange, and that will be followed by The Adventure of the Second Stain. We shall talk about The Adventure of the Abbey Grange. The story starts out where Sherlock wakes up Watson, and seems to be bum-fuzzled. There's been a murder, and they immediately take off to Abbey Grange, which is near... Is it Chislehurst? Does anybody know? Because a one Sir Eustace Brackenstall has been murdered. And quite apparently, it's been done by burglars. We, again, are dealing with Inspector Stanley Hopkins. He seems to be another one of those, like the Marching Peacock, as I think of him. But I digress. Inspector Stanley Hopkins, although on the last story he was involved in, was very much of a critical thinker, was very much of a go-getter, really, and followed really good steps to get to his end game that didn't have much success. This time, he's almost a blundering idiot. I'm like, really? What's the difference here? Stanley believes that it is a gang. Specifically, the infamous Randall gang. Woo-hoo-hoo. And this infamous Randall gang has actually committed several other crimes in the area very recently. Now, once they do arrive on the scene, as it is, Sherlock and Watson start to speak with the lady of the house, which we'll call Lady B from this point forward, who seems to be a very dainty, delicate, well-spoke, well-mannered, high-born individual. And she does share her misadventures with Eustace, being that he wasn't really a good individual. He was a drunkard, and he was mean and violent and had abused her physically. And even her maiden, or her maid, she collaborates this with Watson and Sherlock, telling them about these marks that Sherlock had pointed out, that even she had missed, but she was sure that they had been done, I guess, with jabbing bobby pins into her arm by her husband, Eustace. Lady B tells Sherlock that come about 11 o'clock, she comes across a elderly gentleman coming in through the window, followed by two younger men. The older man immediately strikes her in the face, knocking her out cold. When she comes to, she's tied to a chair. And what she's tied to the chair with is bell rope. Now, if you've ever seen a black and white movie and it's a bedroom, you'll notice what they're talking about. It's a rope that used to hang down that you would grab and pull if you wanted to get something from your butler or kitchen staff or whatever back in the day. Also, it was something that would be very handy and used by people that were invalids. It was at this point that Eustace came into the room. And when Eustace came into the room where he saw his wife tied to the chair, he rushed at the assailants. And one of the intruders of the, quote, infamous Randall gang grabs up a fire poker and bends it over Eustace's head, killing him and leaving him for dead. Lady B, she faints at the sight of such a thing, and then whenever she starts to come to, perhaps a couple minutes later, she saw that the intruders were drinking from wine glasses. And then they decided that they were done wreaking havoc, gathered up some of the silver that they had on the sideboard, and went back out the window and disappeared. Now, we start to find some more things out about Mr. Eustace, being that he was pretty much a garbage individual and a bad human being. He did not know how to people very well. And because of this, he had bad behavior all the time. Like, he poured gas all over Lady B's dog and set it on fire. And that he was already well known for abusing his wife. Holmes starts to look around, and he immediately looks at this bell rope. But he does ask, hey, if that bell rope was pulled that hard to yank it and break it, why come nobody in the kitchen heard it? Because it would have made a ferocious noise. Our sometimes on, sometimes off, Inspector Hopkins relays the information, and hey, look, it was kind of late, and the kitchen staff had already retired to the back of the house, where they probably wouldn't have heard such a thing. That would kind of link the people that were robbing the house to the servants of the house in a way. And it was really odd that since the lady was tied, there wasn't really anybody else around, and the husband was dead on the floor, that they took very little. They only took silver and not a lot of it. The next thing that Sherlock starts to take a look at are the glasses. There's a lot of settlement that's in one of them, and then the other two don't really have that much. And if you're pouring towards the bottom of the bottle, then you should have a little bit more, and then a whole lot. And Watson's recounting at this point of Sherlock's behavior is kind of funny. Well, it wouldn't be funny to Sherlock, but it's kind of funny to me. Sherlock is incredibly upset because this seems to be like a Ron Papil type of a case. You know, you've got all the stuff here. It's set it and forget it, it's done. But on their way to the train station, Sherlock is mumbling to himself more and more, and he keeps going over the little particulars that there's just too many holes, there's too many not quite theirs, and then there's too many details that don't fit into what was actually said happened, and he comes to the conclusion that perhaps Lady B and her servant are lying. They concocted the whole thing, put together a false crime scene to hide something. Sherlock and Watson diverge from the train station and go back to Lady B's estates because he just wants to double check a few things, and he comes to several more conclusions, like with the bell rope and a few other items that don't match up. So he does confront Lady B and Teresa, her servant, giving them the opportunity, saying, "Hey, look, I know that this is false. I know this is not true. So please just tell me the truth." And they stand by their story. They don't take the option. And upon leaving the house a second time, he notices that in the pond, there seems to be a big hole in it. This really gets Sherlock's attention. So he writes Stanley a short note and has it sent later on. Now Sherlock starts to look for something completely different. Now he's convinced it's probably a sailor, not this gang that has caused what's happened to happen. And he starts to do some investigating, and he finds out that Lady B had been on a voyage here lately, and it just so happens that that ship is already took out for sea and is halfway around the world. Their first mate was promoted to a captain, and that captain was still in England, and he was going to be piloting a new ship. And after getting all these little details and things straight, Sherlock and Watson are headed to the Scotland Yard. But Sherlock hesitates right pretty much at the gate, saying, until I get to know a couple more details, let's not just give the police who the actual person was, because I want to find out what's really going on. Later on that evening, Sherlock gets a note from Stanley Hopkins letting him know that, yes, he was correct, that the silver items had gone through to the bottom of the lake. And unlike what Sherlock thinks, which was in the note, Stanley thinks that it was just a temporary hiding place for the silver. On top of that, the Randall gang was arrested in New York, different continent altogether, so there's no way they could have been there for that actual murder. The guy that I had mentioned earlier, the sailor that was now a captain, his name is James. And James comes to Baker Street later on that evening, kind of like clockwork, because Sherlock seems to always set things up so that he'll get a telegram, one person will show up, or this will happen, everything will happen back to back to back in the scene, it seems like. But we find out that Captain Crocker, he was actually the one that did it. And it's because he deeply loved Miss B. They had met on a trip to Australia, but Lady B wasn't necessarily in love with him. And of course, then he starts talking with Teresa, and Teresa tells Captain Crocker about Eustace's behavior towards his wife, Lady B, and how he was abusive in this, that, and the other. And then we find out that Captain Crocker visited with Lady B, and this was just shortly before Eustace was murdered. But whenever he was visiting with Lady B, Eustace rushes in, starts slinging insults like a gunslinger towards his wife, smacks her around with an item, and then turns his attentions to Captain Crocker and starts to attack him, but Crocker defends himself and lays a mighty blow with the fire poker, bending it, killing Eustace. It was in self-defense on Crocker's part, and there's a big conversation that goes back and forth in between Sherlock and Crocker. So Sherlock ends up telling Crocker, look, it's a bad situation, And if you just disappear, everything will probably fall on Lady B, and you'll be in the free and clear, which at that point, Captain Crocker, he gets very upset, and he's like, look, just do whatever you will with me. Throw me in the brig. Throw me in jail for the rest of my life, as long as nothing bad comes to her ever again. That's what's most important to me. And Sherlock shares with him, hey, look, I'm just testing you, and you've passed twice, which is a really good thing. So, look, I've already given the police the hints they need to figure out what was going on, and if they can't figure it out, so be it. Which was kind of cool in a way. Crocker does, you know, go away as him being a captain and all, but he feels like he's done enough. He's given the police this big hint, and if Stanley isn't going to listen to what's been told to him, then okay. So at this point, Sherlock declares that Watson is the jury, because he is the best fit of a man that should ever be a juror, that he was the judge and that Crocker was the baddie in the situation, and gave a not guilty sentence to him and sent him on his way. And now for the last one. Now for the last story in The Return of Sherlock Holmes, The Adventure of the Second Stain. And I really enjoyed this one. I don't know why I enjoyed it so much, but I found myself laughing at parts, really. And that was kind of strange to admit, because the story really was kind of a serious one. Anyhow, there's a few individuals that come to visit with Sherlock and Watson. I think they're actually going to visit with Sherlock, not so much Watson. But anyway, the Prime Minister, Lord Bellinger, and the Right Honorable Trelawney Hope, which was the Secretary of Estate for European Affairs. There is a document that has been stolen from Hope. And this document is a letter from a different country's leader. And this letter would be very damning indeed if it were to get out into the public, and in fact would probably start a war. The document was usually kept in a dispatch box of Hope's, but Hope was the only one that had a key to it. And he's absolutely flummoxed at what could have happened to the document. The Prime Minister fairly well gives Sherlock carte blanche. Do what you will, spend what you will, get this document back. It's very important to us. Really, they didn't want to share any details with Sherlock about what the letter was. They wanted to give a description of the envelope that it was in, but not telling what the letter had to do with. Apparently, a very powerful potentate decided to shoot his mouth off, and it was a bad thing, and even that leader decided that maybe I should have held off just a little bit before doing that. It was stolen during a time period where his wife was out for 4 hours to the theater, and nobody in his house knew about the document whatsoever. They eventually wrap up the meeting, and Watson and Sherlock are sitting and talking about things. Sherlock decides that he's going to start with some of the spies that he knows about, and starts naming off a few. And this is one of the chances that Watson has, and he gets the better of Sherlock, because Sherlock has been so predisposed that he doesn't know that one of the people that he's named that could be a culprit has died, was killed. Before Sherlock and Watson have a chance to leave, Lady Hope shows up, talking about the document, telling Sherlock and Watson that, look, me and my husband, we don't keep any secrets from each other, but my husband does keep politics away from me altogether. He will not discuss anything to do with it, and starts to inquire about this letter. And after her badgering him for a while about what would be in that, Holmes finally breaks down just enough to say, look, if that letter got out, some bad stuff would happen. Maybe not so much to your husband, but to the country as a whole. So, no, if he's not brought you into his confidence, I can't do that. The little spy adventure that Sherlock goes on really doesn't go that well. He doesn't find a whole lot. And I think, in fact, was about to give up on the entire thing altogether when he gets a call. Ooh, from our peacock. Yes, finally! Inspector Lestrade, he is back. But with that aside, Inspector Lestrade invites Sherlock to come to the murder site. Things are actually fairly normal between Sherlock and Lestrade. Whenever Sherlock gets there, Lestrade is doing his, if you're so clever, watch this. And he shows Sherlock this rug where this guy had bled a lot, but there was no, ooh. And curiously enough, if, you know, there's enough blood on the top and the bottom for the bottom to be completely red, shouldn't there be a stain under it? Stain underneath it. Just a small bit of back and forth between Lestrade and Sherlock about this. And, of course, you know, it's a moot point, really, but the the whole rug, or whatever they want to call it, had just been rotated and shifted. So if you had turned it back the other way, then the stains would match up. But it does show something, that the officer that was on duty, that was supposed to be guarding this murder scene, had done something he shouldn't do. He let somebody into where the murder had occurred. And it is upon that officer that should have been guarding the place that Sherlock misdirects Lestrade to go find out who he let into the room. He said, man, don't take any chances here. Make sure that you just assume that it happened and talk like it did happen and it was him, and you'll get a confession. And Lestrade is heard yelling down the hall, going to that officer, and takes him into another room. It is at this point where Sherlock jumps into action, pulls the rug up, and starts searching, finds a hidden wooden panel underneath the rug, reaches in and finds absolutely air. There's nothing in the container, so he quickly puts the wood back, gets Watson to help him put the rug back where it was, and is leaning on the wall just in the nick of time when Lestrade walks back into the room with the officer that had let things slide and let somebody in to the murder scene. And it is at this point that the constable that's supposed to be watching over the thing, the officer on duty, there was this pretty thing that shows up. She's really fair-skinned, and she starts talking to me, and come to find out, she had come because there was an ad in the paper for a typist, but she came to the wrong address, and let's be honest, it's boring here, and I'm lonely. So yeah, I let her in. I started talking to her, and whatever, she came into the crime scene, she saw the blood and fainted, so I went to get her some water. That's all I know, really. And of course, this attractive female entity that shows up takes the time to do this exact same thing that Sherlock had just done, with the exception of they take the papers and disappear. Now the constable was going to be shown off the property. The constable is going to be removed from the scene altogether, but he is being escorted off the property. That Sherlock pulls out a picture from his pocket, shows it to him, and the constable recognizes the picture as the visitor. There's a bit of dialogue here with Watson and Sherlock that I highly enjoyed. And it was kind of funny because, you know, they're working one case, which has to do with this document, and Lestrade thinks that he's working this murder case that has nothing to do with the document, but Sherlock doesn't have to tell him a thing because he's working so high up the chain. Sherlock points out that, you know, they don't know what they're actually working on, so yeah, save us being here. Don't worry about it, Watson, my dear boy. And they take off to go to Lady Hope. And it's upon Sherlock arriving there at the estate where the Hopes live and having an interview with Lady Hope where he's like, hey, you need to really tell me what's going on here. And she feigns ignorance at everything. And Sherlock calls her bluff quite well, because after a whole lot of back and forth, he just was tired of it and calls a servant in from the hall and says, hey, when is Mr. Hope going to be home? Oh, a quarter of an hour. Awesome. And I'll just wait for him and tell him what all's happened. And that was a very smart thing for Sherlock to do, because then he finds out the rest of the story. After the servant leaves the room, oh, Lady Hope falls apart, and she falls apart big. And she recounts the story of how there was, of course, some letters she had wrote whenever she was younger that she didn't want her husband to find and read. So she gets blackmailed into stealing this blue envelope with this particular seal on it and bringing it to this guy at this house. She used, of course, the theater as a way to be able to have time to go do this. When she gets to where she's supposed to drop off this letter and is talking to the guy that has the stuff she's blackmailed with, his wife walks in. I'm guessing it's his wife. It's not really said that it was, but she walks in and goes, aha, I caught you. I knew it. I knew it this whole time, and shoots him. Well, Lady Hope takes off running, forgetting about the documents altogether that had previously been stowed before the wife, the very mad wife, walked in. And she returns a few days later, nuzzles up to this constable, using her feminine charms, as the constable described it, and ends up faking fainting so that she can get back to the documents. Whenever she gets them, she brings them home, and she has them locked up in her writing station, which happens to be in the same room that they're in currently. After finally letting all this stuff out, Sherlock just goes, okay, well, let's fix the situation. Go get me his lockbox, because surely you've got the key And yeah, so they shuffle up the papers a bit, put it at the, near to the bottom, and get the trunk put away just in the nick of time for Mr. Hope to show up. And Mr. Hope has somebody in tow, which is the Prime Minister. Mr. Hope asks his wife to leave because, again, it's a political matter, and they would rejoin her in just a little bit. And Sherlock plays out the scene quite well, saying, "Hey, I've got news. I know where it's at." And they both get very excited. And he's like, "It's in your dispatch box." And Mr. Hope's like, "No, it can't be. I looked there. Everything was out. It was open. There's no way it could still be in that box. I don't get it. There's no way that could be." And Sherlock's like, "Well, why don't you try anyway?" And the Prime Minister puts in his two cents as well, saying, "Hey, you know, it really wouldn't hurt to look. Let's just get that dispatch box." And they send the manservant off to go get it. He brings it back. They open it up. He starts going through it, going, "This isn't it. This isn't it. This isn't it. This is this. Oh, look, here it is." Of course, we already know the solution of what had happened, but Mr. Hope doesn't. And the explanation that is given to Mr. Hope about the whole situation was that perhaps the box got picked up and shuffled. He doesn't really buy it, but he asks Sherlock anyway, "So how did you come to that conclusion?" He's like, "Because I looked at all the places it should have been and I didn't find it, so that left the one place that it should be, which is that it never left the house. If it never left the house, it should be still in your dispatch box. Problem solved, end game." But we really know what happened anyhow, was that his wife got caught up in a bunch of stuff from her previous younger self's life and was trying to get out of it, realized what kind of detriment this was going to have on her husband's career and her country and the world as well, felt really horrible about it, went back and got the documents, and then her and Sherlock put them back in the dispatch box. So yeah, that was probably the reason why I enjoyed it so much. But anyway, that does it. And that being said, I'd love to know what you think about it. Tell me down there in that description. Congratulations, you have done it. That's right, we've made it to the end of the video, and I want to thank you so much for watching today, especially if you stuck it through to the end. If you happen to be new here, we would love to have you join our family. Look for the subscribe button. Should be floating at the end of the video here, or if you don't want to wait for that, down there. Also, if you saw something in here that you liked and enjoyed and think that maybe somebody else would, why don't you throw it a like and share it. If you happen to find a good book in between now and the next video, make sure you tell me about it in the description box down there. We'll check it out, we'll read it together, and we'll have a discussion. Again, today's book has been The Return of Sherlock Holmes. This has been Shane with Shane's Books in Review, and I'll see you in the next video.